Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, great. My name is Elena Crippa. I'm here to chair the first two papers that work really beautifully together, looking back at the exhibitions that Li Wenxia did and were organized afterwards by a number of public and private institutions. So we have the first two speakers. I will just tell you briefly about them. One, Yu-Jie, is a freelance exhibition researcher, and she focuses on contemporary creating histories in Taiwan, Afro-Asian artist diaspora, and cultural production through research on exhibitions and biennials. And current research involves a comparative study of exhibition histories in East Asia, especially the interaction among Taiwan and other countries to construct a picture of exhibition history in Asia and bridge with the West. And then we have following Lucy Steed, who is a reader in art theory and exhibition histories at University of the Arts London. She's a senior research fellow for After All at Central St. Martin's, and this capacity she leads on the exhibition histories, book series, and associated projects. She is called to the teaching team for the research-based Master in Art Exhibition Studies at Central St. Martin's, and as convener of the research network at UAL, she leads on doctoral training across the university. Lucy's publications include Curating After the Global, Our Instructions Think, The Curatorial Conundrum, and Exhibition, all published by the MIT Press in the last 3 years. So thank you so much for coming today to present your research. And I would invite first Yu-Jie to come and present her paper. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Thank you for organizing this amazing event. The performance last night is amazing. I'm very happy to be here to share my research of writing about Li Yuan-Chia. And my search with Li actually began in 2014 when I saw the retrospective exhibition of Li Yuan-Chia in Taipei Fine Art Museum. And well, to be honest, at that time I was not very familiar with that artist. It's such a shame, I know. But I still remember how much I was fascinated by this artist and also his artwork. So, as an exhibition researcher, I mainly look into three exhibitions about Li Yuan-Chia and explores the presentation and also the representation of this artist through the lens of the exhibition in different institutions across time and geographies. So three exhibitions, namely Viewpoints, a retrospective exhibition of Li Yuan-Chia in Taipei Fine Art Museum in 2014, this one. And also the next one will be Li Yuan-Chia, Artist, Curator, Poet and Archivist in Camden Art Center in 2001, this one. And then, now, a close comparison will be conducted between these two retrospectives, questioning how does each institution take Li Yuan-Chia as a figure to achieve its missions and position Li in each art history. And at the same time, I will bring up the final one, which is this one. Where is it? Oh. Watercolor 56 and 57 Li Yuan-Chia in 1977 in LYC Museum. Well, this one will offer a rather close viewpoint for us to understand this artist. So the first case study goes to this one, called Viewpoints, a retrospective exhibition of Li in Taipei Fine Art Museum in 2001, curated by the in-house curator Fang Meijing, featuring over 190 pieces of Li Yuan-Chia's work and also the documents. Before I go further into the exhibition, I would just quickly show a clip of this exhibition, just give you a first impression of this exhibition. So here we have it. There's no sound at all. Thank you. short clip. Okay, it's all right. Okay. In fact, this was not the first retrospective of Lee in Taiwan. Instead, his friend from Tongfang Painting Group curated one in 1998. However, this is the first time that this artist was presented in a government-funded museum in Taiwan. So the arrangement followed four geographic locations Lee moved chronologically from Bologna, from Taipei, Bologna, to London, and then to Cumbria. Each section featured the transformation of his abstract idea via his moving, and also highlights the philosophical ideas running through his artworks. So first, we have the first period, that's Taipei period, and showcasing his drawings and watercolors produced this time. However, in this section, I would highlight that this section was explicit on his learning with Li Zhongshen, an independent teacher and artist, and also Li's involvement with Tongfang Painting Group. Here we saw the flyer and also picture, quite small, that's why I'm showing this one. So to explain a little bit more, Tongfang were one of the painting groups in Taiwan around 1950s and 60s. The joint member were mostly born before World War II and came to Taiwan with the retreat of Chiang Kai-shek. They were the first advocator who manifest their pursuit toward modern art and with their sharp declaration and also the pioneering actions in the post-war Taiwan. So here we see the exhibition flyer of Tongfang Painting Exhibition, slightly different from the one that exhibits in TFEM's exhibition, because at that time they have several ones during that time. So this is one of the exhibition. And the next two pictures was Li Yuan-Chia and also his fellow friend from Tongfang Painting Group. Okay, so then we come to the second section, narrates Li's time in Italy. Artwork here are mostly the collections of Ganiva's family and some Tate collection majorly purchased in 2004 were also included in this section. Then we came to his staying in London and Cumbria, rather exhibits like separately. These two times were exhibits together. The audience will kind of arrive the climax of this exhibition, the LYC and also Lee's installations. Here we saw his very famous magnet points. And additionally, the most special one is this one, the hanging offcuts around 1990s. And this one was never shown in any exhibition in public before. So here is the installation view in Taipei Fine Art Museum. And below is the exhibition view in LYC Museum. And also, in order to give the audience a full insight of LYC, TFEM actually made a full wall of photocopies of reviews and pictures. Also, a dark room was made to exhibit three slide sequences which were made from the transparency of Lee's produce in his late time. Two projected on the wall and one projected on the floor with several movable chairs. The chair is reproduced as the Li Yuan-Chia's furniture. And of course, these lay hand color photographic works were also included here. So my point is, the strategy of display show an ambition of TFEM to celebrate the success of this artist from a Taiwanese subjectivity by linking to his Chinese nationality and trace back his time in Taiwan. It reviews Li's career as an artist and most importantly, reclaim him back to Taiwanese contemporary art history. It was curated in a traditional way for an artist retrospective, which is more close, I would say more close to an art historian or art historical writing, seeking for peer recognition, but might be a little bit lack of direct contact with the public when it comes to the practical side, such as practice, such as material, such as the process. Like T-Fan's exhibition, most of the artworks were roped out from the audience, losing its tie with the public and elaborating Lee in a biographic narrative, mainly focusing on Lee himself, rather his thoughts. Then I will quickly jump to my second example, Li Yuanjia, artist, curator, poet, and archivist. In 2001, Institute of International Visual Arts, as we call it, in NIVA, with Camden Art Center, produced the first institutional retrospective of Li. And this exhibition was curated by Guy Brett, an art critic, and also a close friend to Li. It was part of INIVA's project in 2004, which presents over 100 artists and writers from Britain and across the world. Instead of starting from Li's time in Taipei, this exhibition starts directly from the dot, drawing different aspects of Li's art through his painting, relief, collage, hardboard, installation, photos, and films. The arrangement of the exhibition indicates how Li Yuanjia visualized his thoughts through various formats and chosen materials and describe different roles that he plays while he running LYC Museum, as suggested in the exhibition title. He is an artist, he's a curator, he's a poet, at the same time, he's the archivist for LYC Museum. And then the audience will also encountered a room showcasing three slides displayed in a dark room, which exactly was the same as T-Fan did. The curator, Guy Brett, said in the interview, this idea was coming from Lee's little dark room in his tiny flat and how he creates the slides. Lee's slides were produced from different angles, some were from above, some were overlapped, and some were appear parallel. Here we see the two installations, similar installation, but in different exhibition. Then we had a room exhibit his most well-known artworks, the magnetic points. These points in this exhibition, I would say, invites the public to touch, to move, and even to arrange. Which, on the contrary, in Taipei's exhibition, the audience were not allowed to touch these magnetic dots. So, say the guy Brad in the interview as well, in the beginning, we already decided that we must allow the viewers to touch and play with these magnet points. So, as a result, as the first retrospective about this artist, in Britain, rather than tracing back where he was from, how do this work related to what British artists are doing today, and asking how his artworks could be presented for a British generation who did not see them, were the first two priorities for the curator. So in a sense, this interpretation from the curator already differentiates this exhibition from the TFM one. It contains a curatorial mindset already, and the whole exhibition became a curatorial object containing a particular subject-object relations. Then, I will back to my previous question. What is the significance and meaning that Li Yuanjia exhibits in each country, in each institution? Actually, it is quite surprising to me that T-Fan, Taipei Fine Art Museum, suddenly had a huge exhibition about this artist. As far as I know, before 2000, Li Yuanjia was not widely recognized, not just in Western world, but but also in Taiwan as well. Even though Wen Li was again represented in a gallery again this year, surprisingly knowing that there are many people actually didn't see this exhibition in Taipei Fine Art Museum. So I would say till now Li Yuan-Jia still not very widely known by Taiwanese public. So I will back to TFM. When TFM, Taipei Fine Art Museum, was established in 1983, it was responsible to handle the collection of modern art. As its director, Huang Guangnan, addressed, in terms of time, TFM had grown primarily from the post-war period from 1945 to the present. In terms of the locality, the outstanding works of Taiwanese artists will be the priority. And the second will be the overseas Chinese artists and other works representing the major trend of 20th century artistic thought. So in other words, as the foremost and largest art museum in Taiwan, TFM has its responsibility and rightfulness to write Taiwanese art history after post-war period through its exhibition as well as collections. However, amongst other art museums in Taiwan, I would say TFM particularly deal with more issues of Taiwanese identity, even though it is a city museum, but its realization was from a central government in Taiwan in 1979, which means it definitely deal more political issue concerning about Taiwanese identity. In fact, I would say after so many years, TFM still struggles and debates on this internal issue about Taiwanese identity, especially when it has an international exhibition such as Taipei Biennial or Taiwanese Pavilion in Venice Biennial. The issue of Taiwanese identity is always seriously criticized from the public. So following this context, Li Yuan-Jia was rationally an artist to reclaim and to represent. Indeed, TFM fulfilled this mission and offer a wonderful opportunity to look into this important artist. However, I would argue that Li actually left Taiwan before 1970s and never came back. His leaving was not just simply a political impulse, but more likely an artistic driven. His keen pursuit to Western art. After he left, his art had already veered away from a Taiwanese context to a very different direction. His art is more correspondent to the Western context, like his numerous participations in many significant art exhibitions, such as Anno 62 in Rotterdam, and also his participation in Play Orbit in 1962, in ICA, in London, and even the pioneers of participatory arts in Museum of Modern Art in Oxford. These exhibitions were scarcely mentioned in the exhibition of TFM or only appeared in a catalog with few lines. But however, I feel like that it's fair that TFM choose to mention little about these exhibition, but on the one hand, it might be a bit risky for TFM to crown him as a father or the pioneer of abstract painting in Taiwan, since this title is somehow in spirit of a linear art historical writing, contains a cause and effect relation. And on the other hand, this also held a need for constructing Taiwanese art history. I would argue that these Chineseness perhaps will never really come home if we didn't construct a very detailed Taiwanese art history. But however, after this exhibition, more artists from Tongfang Painting Group were exhibits. Like we have 2016, we have Huo Kong, and also we have Xia Yang in 2018. Perhaps a comprehensive research for this period of this time through related artists is what we can expect from TFEN in the future. So for another exhibition in Camden Art Center, I would like to set my focus on INIVA. Established in 1994, INIVA as an institution features on artists who are overlooked to address the imbalance in the representation of culturally diverse artists and challenge the mainstream by creating a platform for debates, the intersection of politics and global identity through visual arts. For this exhibition, I feel a need that I need to look back to the Momentum exhibition, The Other Story, in Hayward Gallery in 1989. As the curator Rushing Aran says in The Other Story, the unique of story of those men and women who defy their otherness and enter the modern space that was forbidden to them, not only to declare their historical claim on it, but also to challenge the framework which defy and protect its boundaries, bringing in the works from the margins of invisibility, misunderstanding, and neglect into the mainstream. So The Other Story was a response to the movement from the Third World War. By focusing on 24 Afro-Asian artists who have developed their art career and live in post-war period. So if we follow The Other Story and then the development of INIVA, the curatorial intention to decolonize or expand the canon of British art history was implied in this exhibition in Camden Art Center already. So here's the installation view in The Other Story of these artworks. Lee was already framed with the process of decolonization across the country to complete Aran's international landscape of contemporary British art history and his ambition to challenge the British canon inside an art institution. Lee became a role of the other for British art and got into the mainstream by defying his otherness. However, instead of focusing Lee's otherness from his nationality, I would like to specify that the exhibition in Camden Art Center marked a departure from it, took another otherness that embedded in Lee, that was Lee's development of the dots as a format and conceptual device. So by displaying these transparencies with curators' own interpretation and reproduction and remaining the interaction between works and the audience, the curator highlights the uniqueness in Lee's work, creating, or we can say living, the moments of communicating and interacting beyond culture and linguistic boundaries, realizing Lee's ideas of making public. Most importantly, this curatorial strategy did make Lee an access to British art history, a unique other, a unique contribution to expand the mainstream of British art from 1960s to 1990s. So from Hayward Gallery to Camden Art Center, then to the TFEN, Lee was reframed by different institutions. As Sky Brett described, the more I suggest complexity, the further I feel I move from the actual experience of these arts. Of course, these displays relied on several practical aspects, but with all these exhibitions, these thoughts were merely a way of expressing or serving as a channel to approach him rather than ourselves. However, my final question will be, what Lee thought about institution? Perhaps the exhibition watercolor 1977 could give us some ideas about how he institutionalized himself and propose a possible case for of an institution for us. The exhibition was one of the over 300 exhibitions in LYC, the catalog designed by Lee himself, and with an autobiography starting as, I arrived from this beautiful earth, then following with, from one Chinese orphanage to another, during these 12 years of highly disciplined institutional life, I have no direct contact with the outside world. The isolation and disconnected from the highly disciplined institutional life is a push for him to think over institution. This could be a possibility about his keen search for relationship and interaction with the audience and the environment, as we see the children and the visitor literally play in his museum. And yes, in the catalog, though he traced the origin of his thoughts back to Chinese culture, but once he arrived in the West, his thoughts and later his museum embraced the communication with other cultures. They were beyond languages, create interaction and change his institution into an artwork. As a visitor to the museum, all you need is your body, your movement, and your presence. You were part of the artwork. In LYC, the Yuan-Chia states, LYC is me, LYC is all of you. He shared a highly intimate relationship with his audience. It crushed the hierarchical wall of an institution and even proposed a special case to us today. Among these exhibitions, Lee and his artworks should not be seen simply as an individual from one place to another, but a mutual communication. Every exchange will prolong artists' and artworks' lives or articulate other values and aspects to present artists and artwork differently. Of course, there isn't an ideal model to present Lee, not only because it is impossible, but also the ever-changing states of the artwork is the most fascinating part of an exhibition. We cannot and should not judge that two retrospectives are correct or right, because each of them deal with its time, its space, its public, its mission. Perhaps next step for us is to find out more approach to Li Yuanjia, such as Tate Modern placed Li in a group exhibition called Structure and Clarity in 2014. And more recently, we have each modern gallery in Taipei doing an exhibition about Li and young generation artists, which gives us a wonderful opportunity to see how Li's art, again, across time and geographies, to create and foster a communication with other artists. So in this way, more heightened parts of Li will be unfolded, and most importantly, LYC reminds us the question was not about how Li Yuanjia can be seen, but about how we see ourselves. How to present Li, in other words, it means that how we see our art history. Thank you so much.
I want to focus on this work here. Let me see if I can make this work. Which we've seen in Yu-Jie and Hamad's pictures. But I want to look at it in particular here at Manchester Art Gallery almost three decades ago. This is Li Wanchia's floating disc toy, which dates back, as we've heard, to the late 1960s, and it's been continuously reworked since. These suspended colored discs, 1, 2, 3, 4, are made of steel, and they carry movable magnets, often circles in themselves, and they invite and reward curious fingers. The whole piece is participatory or interactive. You are supposed to touch and shift the photo-covered magnets, to play with them. This piece gives multiple form to Yuan-Chia's core formal and conceptual concern, namely the point. From the large disks to the small magnets, we have numerous points. And this is Lee's term. We've heard the point, and he uses it to indicate, as Hammad quoted, the origin and the end of creation. We saw that beautifully last night. I'm guessing the venue in this picture is obvious to you. We're looking at the gallery space in this very building, although I gather that this particular space is now the museum offices, just opposite us. So you can't literally go and look in this space right now. The image predates the 2002 refurbishment of the Manchester Art Gallery, and the room shown, which was known as the Princess Street Gallery, was the main home for temporary exhibitions at the institution in the year 1990, which is when this picture was taken. But what's the specific exhibition context that we're looking at here? If you visited Speech Acts, the exhibition that anchors today's symposium, then you'll know there's a magnetic playground inspired by Yuan-Chia's floating disc toy upstairs, waiting for you to have fun with it. But what brought this particular piece to Manchester Art Gallery almost 30 years ago? Here are some more clues. And to give it away, I'm going to zoom into this wall here, where you can see the title. This is the wall that would have greeted you as you entered the gallery. The other story is an important exhibition that was curated by Rashid Areen with a descriptive subtitle, Afro-Asian Artists in Post-War Britain. This show, which opened at the Hayward Gallery in London in 1989 before touring to Wolverhampton and Manchester the following year, united work by a selection of artists, all largely neglected by the white British establishment at the time. As we've heard, it brought together 24 artists of three generations, with the earliest work exhibited dating back to the 1930s, although recent practice up to the 1980s was included throughout. A modern and contemporary art survey, foregrounding those usually left out of such shows on racist grounds, it met a mixed critical reception at the time, with the old guard proving dismissive, if not derisive, and those who were more aware that cultural change was badly needed, defending it strongly. The exhibition's achievements are easy to see in retrospect, with many of its participating artists more recently celebrated. And yet the need to combat racism in art and other spheres persists in our society, and therefore the show's overall message remains timely, as compelling, in fact, as the works of art that it showcased. This poster for the show in Manchester flagged that it was a split-site exhibition. Only half the show featured here, and the other half was shown at Corner House, which has more recently become home. That said, I'm going to be focusing on the half of the other story here at Manchester Art Gallery, as this is where Yuan-Chia's work was included. And we're going to pause at 1990 at this point and jump back two decades of time in order to trace the exhibition history of this work. As far as I know, Floating Disc Toy dates from Lee's establishing his studio at Boothby in Brampton in Cumbria in 1968. So we're rewinding to the second half of the 1960s to trace this work as emerging from that context, hot on the heels of Lee's departure from London. This image shows Floating Disc Toy, or something like it, installed in Lee's Cumbrian studio for an exhibition he staged there in October 1968. Here again, as with the other story 20 years later, we have a classic installation shot where no human bodies feature, which does something of a disservice to the interactive or playable works of art. And here we see Lee in the same space, although the formal exhibition has by this time closed, I think. The shot shows the artist in his studio, as photographed by Richard DeMarco, a couple of months after the previous shot. Now closer to the floating discs, we can see that on at least some of them, the magnets are not further points covered in photos, as we saw in the other story, but in this instance, they take a diverse variety of shapes. And we've seen this image before, so I don't need to speak to it specifically. I really love how Floating Disc Toy is interspersed with other works by Lee here in these three Brampton studio shots. It's never on its own. I think we need to ask if Floating Disc Toy is a standalone work in this context. I get the feeling there is no autonomy, only interrelation with other works. Right, let's move on to another exhibition context. In October and November of 1969, Lee showed suspended discs with magnetic points in his second solo show at the Listen Gallery in London, which was titled Golden Moon Show. 30 years later, Guy Brett recalled the exhibition precisely. The Listen then was a small space with a number of white painted rooms and an additional space built out the back of unpainted breeze blocks. Through these rooms, Lee scattered his lexicon of points, end quote. And here, in the office-based section of the gallery show which we're looking at, we can see the magnets are indeed more identifiably points, rather than the more wayward shapes on the discs used a year before in Lee's Brampton studio in Cumbria. I'm going to spin us round now, so we're going to stay in this room, but turn around and look back to the window that's opposite. Forgive this image, it's a photo of a photo, so ignore the red panel at the right if you can. So this is one space, the first space within the Listen exhibition. We're going to look at another space within the same show. Here, the coloured steel discs with their magnetic points feature in this further section of the show, with leaves here covering the floor. And there are floor-based structures made from loose breeze blocks here present too, constellating with the discs suspended from the ceiling. And Hammad showed us this image. Carrying on with the words of Guy Brett in 2000, quote, the back room was a single environment called Life Station. Here the point became the golden seat of a swing, your support as you swung over a floor covered in autumn leaves, in a room whose four uniform walls were linked up by chaotic strands of coloured plastic rope, end quote. The circular point shape of the swing seat is still clearer in these shots. I want to argue that in this golden seated swing, we have another sort of floating disc toy. Let's now stay in London, but move across to the Institute of Contemporary Arts, or the ICA, to an exhibition that opened the day that this show, the Golden Moon Show, closed. Here the context for Lee's Disc Toy is a group show curated by Yasha Reichardt, then ICA Assistant Director, in collaboration with Peter Jones of the Welsh Arts Council. As described by Reichardt, the show, called Play Orbit, brought together, quote, toys, games, and playables produced by people who are not professionally involved with the design of playthings, but who work in the field of the visual arts, end quote. Here we might note that Lee's disc toy carries magnets that are characterized by letters as well as taking a variety of shapes. Perhaps most strikingly, the whole thing is static, like a painting, not suspended freewheeling from the ceiling. Maybe this anticipates and welcomes rather heavier usage than previously courted in the earlier exhibition context that we've looked at. I'm guessing more visitors were expected here at the ICA than at the Listen Gallery or in Lee's Boothby Studio. And consonant with this, I'm at last able to show you an image of a disc toy in action. A child is busy here with the magnets. This image is a film still, film footage of the Play Orbit exhibition in London, is now freely available online. I haven't added it in, I didn't think we had time for it, but I encourage you to go and watch this object played with online. The reportage, as shot by Pathé News, allows us to see something of the interaction with children with the artworks or exhibits. The footage also shows us somewhat how the contributions to the show were gathered together. Although I'm afraid Lee's disc toy is not itself here contextualised, we can get a sense of how humbly his piece might have operated within the playground of the wider exhibition. Our next leap on the trail of Lee's disc toy takes us to the LYC Museum and Art Gallery, as we've heard, opened in 72 at Banks on Hadrian's Wall in Cumbria. These photographs were taken in the second half of the 1970s, and I like them because they're really busy, but it means it's quite hard to see the work that's here. hear more clearly. Interestingly, in light of the Play Orbit exhibition that we've just left behind in London, these new images land us in a part of Lee's museum particularly dedicated to children. And yet, at the same time, I think I'm right to say that it's also where workshops for adults took place within LYC. In other words, this is a space that invites art production of all sorts, by all sorts, regardless of age, and this transforms the artist's earlier Boothby Studio scenario into a more fully open and inhabitable offer, with his disc toy here again at its heart. I see something of Play Orbit and something of Lee's Boothby Studio exhibition and something of his Boothby Studio as workspace here in this LYC installation of his disc toy. I've got an open question for you. Does anybody help me identify this? I think it's at LYC.
It is LYC.
It is. Thank you very much. I'm fascinated by this because I'm not sure what sort of event we're looking at. Is it a studio-style installation? Is it an exhibition? Perhaps answers or productive, complicating information will emerge today, and I'd welcome that. I'm intrigued by this photograph in part because I assume it shows precisely the discs that were included in the other story, the 1989-90 exhibition that I opened my presentation with, and back to which I'm about to jump. But I'm also intrigued by this photograph because I assume it is three of these very discs that were purchased in 2004 for Tate's collection under the title Hanging Disc Toy, and specifically hanging rather than floating. Although if this is the case, and if there was a change of title, it's not reflected in Tate's acquisition files. But putting those details aside, let's pick back up the narrative and move to the opening iteration of the Other Story exhibition at the Hayward Gallery in London in 1989. Where I believe we'll see these discs. We've seen this image, it's the exterior of the Hayward at the time of the show, so you might recognize the promotional poster. We saw it before on the railings outside this building. And we're gonna jump straight into the exhibition. All right, if you know the space, we're in the raised gallery at the back of the lower floor of the Hayward. And we're in this chapter of the exhibition dedicated to David Madala. But the ensuing chapter, Yuan-Chia's chapter, is visible here. Just want to indicate these works. These are time toy. They're related to the floating disc toy, and they incorporated the intermittent chimes from dismantled clocks. So now we're going to head on into this space and look more fully at his representation within the other story. Here, Rashid Areen's own personal chapter of his show is visible in the distance, but it's Lee's magnetic disc works, here and here, that claim the foreground, especially mushroom toy on the ground, in the foreground, but also the floating disc toy suspended behind. Here we see a more museological hang than in Lee's first Boothby studio show back in 1968, by which I mean there is more space between individual works, and the suspended discs are grouped all together rather than being distributed across a given space in between or blending with other works. And here I'm just whizzing us back to Boothby for quick contrast, but also for comparison to find similarity as well as difference. Returning again to the other story at the Hayward in 1989, I'm here overlaying images of Lee's work to show how the suspended discs freely rotated their coloured faces. Although certainly more museological than at Boothby 2 decades before, there is nonetheless an installation here that likewise suggests a single living whole rather than isolated parts. The chimes of time toy must have playfully spread themselves into the adjacent silent works. And visitors' bodies moving between the magnets on the mushroom tables and those on the suspended discs must also have done the work of articulating, if not integrating, the otherwise distinct elements. I see a carefully orchestrated whole here, not entirely dissimilar from Lee's much earlier presentation in his studio-turned exhibition space. But let's come back to Manchester to conclude. Here, with less space available for the exhibition, we see just 4 suspended discs were included, not the 12 that were in London. And there's no accompanying mushroom or time toys. But I love that here a floating disc toy is not hung at a unified height, as it was in London, but at least in one instance, low to the ground, perhaps to entice children. Moreover, a conspicuous bonus of the Manchester hang of the other story relative to the London iteration is that it didn't detach Lee's work from those of his friends and peers, David Medalla and Rashid Areen, by positioning walls between them, but instead it set them all in relation. So we're looking at Rashid's work here and David Medalla's work here. There is a particular felicity, I feel, in the positioning of floating disc toy alongside another work, also suspended from the ceiling, David Medalla's Stitch in Time. This itself dates back to the late 1960s and essentially invites visitor interaction, like Lee's piece. Medalla's Stitch in Time asks you to embroider or otherwise adorn his suspended strip of canvas. And in the next image, which comes from Manchester Art Gallery's own archives, we're going to zoom into the end of the canvas so you can see that right here. You leave your mark in an enduring way here, more so than Lee encourages with his floating disc toy. But both pieces ask you to get busy with your own input and your own expression in dialogue with those others participating. Moreover, I need to highlight that encouraging this or other forms of visitor engagement or activity was an avowed commitment of shows at Manchester Art Gallery at this time. Howard Smith on the curatorial team, who is responsible for working on the hang with Andrew Dempsey from the Hayward, has helpfully drawn my attention to the preceding programme of shows in precisely the same space, which in more or less similar form also had a participatory agenda, specifically during and immediately after the early leadership of Julian Spalding. What the other story offers in coming into such a context is a history for such an agenda within artistic practice, specifically highlighting artists' concern in the 1960s with the problems of auratic masterpieces, that is, the limitations of their demanding passive visitors. But the resonances of looking at floating disc toy in this museum in 1919, for me, lie more in the LYC Museum, which had preoccupied Lee for more than a decade in the previous two. The association of Lee with his collegial peers in London in the late 1960s, that is, the drawing out of his strong bond with David Medalla in particular, but also of his relationship to Rashid Areen's contemporary practice too, this points towards a sociality that seems crucial to me. This is a sociality that was evident in Lee's role in the Tongfang group in Taipei in the 1950s, then in the Il Ponto group in Bologna, all before Lee arrived in London. It is this sociality that fed the LYC Museum and allowed it to blossom. And I have to say, it's a sociality that the other story in London inadvertently squeezed out of the picture. Thank you.
I would just like to comment on a couple of aspects that really fascinated me. On one side is the methodology of exhibition series and how much it feels pertinent to the work of Li Wan-Cha. Particularly, I think it's more than Ahmad started describing the LYC Museum in terms of two aspects, one of the socialized narratives happening, and one is more the institutional infrastructure nature of the place. And I think exhibition histories, in the way you have utilized them, very much address these two major issues of the work existing in between the artist and an audience, and on the other side, a sort of institutional side and the particular constraints of the space. Yu-Jie goes so far as talking about the sort of way in which the artist institutionalized themselves to a point. And also a question that sort of has been coming to my mind is how much in a way we can hope as a curator and art historian to truly reproduce the intimacy of the experience of the work in the LYC Museum and how much representations and replicas can be effective. And just by hearing today members of the audience reminiscing about the experience of being in the museum, I find that incredibly touching and really much made me think of Sueli Rolnick's project when she was working around the Lydia Clark work and archive, and a project of documenting video interviews of people talking about their experience of the work in events organized by the artists, and how much that informed that experience in the working space. And I really started feeling documenting the experience of people here working in the museum might provide as much really of an insight as seeing the work represented in the spaces. But just coming to questions, I'm sure you have burning questions, and I don't want to take too much of your time, but I just wanted to ask you, Yu-Jie, about, I mean, you were very generous in saying, of course, it's up to our historians and curators to take different paths in the reading of these narratives, and yet I felt there was a clear, you know, critical take, particularly in the Taipei show, and how much there was this intent of projecting a national identity on the artists. And in a way, it made me think of Hamad's first comment today when he was saying, well, maybe we should be more critical of these monolithic art histories or, you know, tight narratives, we want to say. And I just wanted to see if you want to comment at all more about this and maybe in relation to your different view on the direct approach.
I feel like I can see that these two retrospective exhibition takes a very different aspect, since the curator is different already. The curator, one curator is from Taiwan, and she works in Taipei Art Museum. Of course, she will verb from a very, okay, we need to reclaim this artist, come back to our art history. But on the other hand, I feel like probably Guybrad's exhibition is more open-minded sense, that which can, for Guybrad, he can kind of expand more possibility about the dots rather than in Taipei Art Museum, because it's a museum for a government-funded museum. Of course, the curator has stick to the Yuan-Chia's nationality. Of course, I won't comment if it's correct or right, but I think it's just different approach, and at the same time, these different approach can kind of project different aspect of Li Yuan-Chia and help us to know this artist a bit more. And so that's why I bring up the final one that Li Yuan-Chia curated for himself, just have three different dimensions of this artist. So I won't say there is correct or right, it just...
But do you have a preference?
I would say if I was in different position, if I work in Taipei for that reason, definitely perhaps I will follow Fang Meijing's approach, but I would like to have more interaction, create more interaction between the works and the audience, because as far as I remember, in Taipei for that reason, they actually did create a space that the audience could actually move the dots, but it's not the work, but it's the reproduction of it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but if I was a Guybrad.
Don't worry, I don't want to push you as far as
But if I'm the Yuan-Chia, I definitely will remain the interaction with the audience, because that's the core of his value.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was interesting about you both that you spoke about mutual communication, and you, Lucy, I think you used the word sociality particularly to talk about this work. And what I found very interesting about this last part of your paper is that, to me, you seem to suggest that how successful the presentation is in reflecting the nature of the work is not so much being loyal to the presentation within the YC Museum, potentially, which might not be possible, but more in terms of quite subtle way in which you establish relationship in space and you suggest possible encounters and relationships with the work of other artists. And I just want, if you want to expand a little bit on the social sociality and how you think, why it was successful here and not elsewhere.
I think it's successful because it reflected the context that generated these works. So David Medalla was in conversation with Li Wan-Chia me, that's the reason he comes to London. He's invited by David Medalla. So there is a dialogue there. Their practice is in dialogue. So when exhibiting their art, you are bringing that into interrelation, it's even historical accuracy. You know, as an art historian, you might want to do that. There an interrelation that was there in the world and you represented in the gallery. So there's a faithfulness to the context of creation. In the relation to LYC's oral histories, I did want to flag that the Innova publication that accompanied the Camden show does include oral histories in quite an important way, I think. Mm-hmm. And I would say that oral history is a really important part of exhibition histories as a methodology. Mm-hmm. I think it means that we're limited in how far we can look back. But when we have instances that are within living memory, it's an absolutely vital resource. In response to the sort of conversation that was emerging here, I wanted to bring up the idea of museum being, for me, about collecting. And the big thing about TFAM is a collecting institution, Tate's a collecting institution, and there are different obligations, whereas Camden is not. It's a contemporary art display space, in a way. And this is what's interesting. One of the fascinating things about LYC is it calls itself a museum. It's definitely the LYC Museum, but it's not about acquisition, it's not about conservation, it's about practice. Mm-hmm. And that, for me, is one of the beautiful things about the museum.
Yeah, absolutely. And beyond that, I think there are even more banal reasons. So when the work was a kind of property, it was in the ownership of the artist, so he could choose how it was treated. By the time it's shown in 2014 in Taipei, it's owned by private museums, and curators will set very different restrictions on the way the work is experienced. But I'm sure you will have questions, so we probably have very little time, but please go ahead.
I just wanted to say that in the entrance of the LYC, there were Roman relics. There were Roman relics.
Yes.
In the entrance of the museum. I think that's, would you tell us why it's called a museum? Yeah. It's a museum, is it, in the art gallery, the rest of
it's possible also that the. Because he had an alliance with the family who owned him the land, who were still discovering some really important things under the earth. So I don't know if he had that alliance before he conceived of the museum and called it the museum.
It's a good point, because it's and art gallery, so they're put alongside each other. It's not just the museum. It's important. Thank you.
I think he had a relationship.
Pedagogical dimension also had a role in
the
museum for the space. So, yeah.
Yes, I was wondering, because I also showed in a museum, obviously. I'm Madeline Waycast. And I find it for his place more like a social sculpture, you know, relating to boys. And I was wondering, I haven't heard that saying to you, the art historian, using that. That's what I think she was doing, the social sculpture.
Do you want to?
Just wanted to bring that in.
And this is a museological conundrum, particularly with historic social sculptures. How social can it be if you're going to also conserve it? I'm interested in looking at the Tate's acquisition files for the floating disc toys. There's a correspondence between Guy asking for them to be made participatory. And he's fully aware that that's problematic. If they're going to last forever, they can't be used constantly. So he makes lovely suggestions. He suggests that every other weekend you can have access. So you limit the contact, or that the gallery invigilators might be allowed or asked to move them. So, you know, there's a real thoughtfulness about, there are ways around it, sorry.
Allowing spectators to move, unfortunately, in the 2001 exhibition resulted in but I think it was a risk worth taking, because we learned how Taipei Fine Arts Museum resolved that predicament.
successful. It was, I remember reproductions in the special space were, I think, the most occupied of the whole exhibition.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think the participants, as they held and moved the points, were thinking, is this the original art?
Yeah.
I don't think so. So I think it was really well resolved.
Mm-hmm. And it's resolved, and similarly here with the magnetic playground that is obviously from all the pieces of paper on the wall.
Yeah.
That's a very active space here too.
Can we take a few more? But please go ahead. You've been there for a while. No?
I was wondering if you guys can speak about the work and how, like, what was the influence around it? Because I can't help but see Buddhist Zen mandalas as an influence on these work, and as someone who is a migrant who was living here, I don't know when he made these work, 1966, how many years he had been in UK, and what that influence had on him, because I feel like, I mean, it's called floating disc, and so there's this philosophical sort of spiritual aspect to it, and with Zen mandala, they're meant to create the universe in a very spiritual form. And I'm just trying to see if there's some sort of hybrid tendency or this relation, like transcultural relationship that he had with different spaces that he's been. And the fact that you have to move, that's a very participatory thing, which is, see it with the Zen mandalas, and I'm just wondering if you could speak a little bit about that in relation to his experience of living in another place. Which,
are you able to comment on this?
I can say a big yes, but there are probably people in the room who can do better justice of that. I think the way he conceptualized very precisely, it wasn't sort of generically Zen, he conceptualized as the point. That's how he marshaled that. The connection between the cosmos, or, you know, so, yeah. I'm,
another question.
Yeah.
Well, I can say my next talk actually is about Buddhism and the action in the next session.
Perfect.
You might come to your point. But I also just wanted to quickly say, probably Madeline's point about social sculpture. Mm-hmm. I think while that picture's up there, and we've got David Madonna's sort of stitching the universe, to recognize that he took part in exploding galaxies before as well. And so that notion of Madonna's biokinetic sculpture was part of, you know, part of sculpting with people. Mm-hmm. Is part of his practice, I think, very much so.
Yeah. Thank you for that. You also have a question.
It's fine, we can save it for later. I'm going to ask over coffee.
But Lucy wants to say something.
No, I just want to ask people that know more about the images that I've shown, particularly LYC, please come and grab me at lunchtime so we can.
Very good. Thank you so much.
Thank you.